Well, thank you so much for leading us. That song was another request from me. last week, I mentioned that there was a song that I requested, and this was another one. It's by the Porter's Gate, if you're interested in finding it. The Porter's Gate is a collective of musicians that came together in New York City a number of years ago, and they've been writing and recording songs that I think are really good, really creative and artistic, and speak to things that I think really matter to the church. And this one is about the humility of Christ and how we can depend on Him even in the darkest valleys. So, thank you for doing that. I do want to mention, just before I get into the message, there's been some questions of me and rightfully so, when I'm going to talk about the conflict in Israel, and I've been thinking about that, and to me it's hard to talk about because there's so much behind what's going on there. There's so much that is hard to understand. And so my posture has been to simply pray for them, and I invite you to do that as well. But if you are interested in digging into some of the deeper things of what's going on there, there's prophecies throughout the whole Bible from beginning to end that revolve around the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel is God's people that He established, starting with Abraham. And there are words that have been spoken all throughout history about that nation. And some of the prophecies have been fulfilled, and some have not yet been fulfilled. And I believe that all things that God has promised will come to pass at some point. If they haven't yet, then they will. He finishes what He starts. And so if you're interested in getting a little bit of insight into that, particularly around the prophecies that have been fulfilled and have yet to be fulfilled, there's a great resource that I'm really thankful for, because it means that it takes a burden off of me to get into all of this stuff. I want to get into it more than I have, but one of our churches, our EMCC churches, the denomination that we're a part of, in Ontario, in Waterloo, Trinity EMC, they did a live conversation where they addressed these things and answered some questions, and it's really helpful. It's long, it's almost 2 hours, but that hardly does it justice. But if you're interested in that, it's on our website and on our social media, so if you want to find it, there's a link. If you go to the sermons area of the website, you should be able to find it there, or on Facebook, we posted it there. So please dig into that if you're interested, and if you have questions about it and want to have more conversation, I don't have answers per se, but I'm interested in the conversation for sure. And so if you want to discuss that for the purpose of praying better, being better informed, then definitely let me know if you want to do that, and I encourage you to pray for that situation, because as we can see, things could potentially become much worse than they are, and ultimately we, I think, should pray for peace and for God to bring about His purposes through that part of the world. So I'm gonna pray for that now, and then pray for the message as we get into Colossians. Heavenly Father, we believe that You are a fulfiller of promises. And it says in Your word that in Jesus, all of Your promises are yes and amen. And so we trust that that You are bringing about the fulfillment of Your promises constantly in times of peace and in times of war. And in this time of war in the Middle East, in Israel, we think of Ukraine, we think of Jordan and Syria. And we just pray that your peace will prevail, that your people will be kept safe from harm, that they will trust in your provision and not in the ability for humans to prevail, but in the ability for you to prevail. So we lift them up and we ask for that in Jesus' name. And as we enter into this passage in Colossians, I pray that our wisdom will increase. I pray that you would give the words to us that we need to hear this morning so that we can be a wise church and ultimately bring glory to you in this community. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we started a series in Colossians a few weeks ago, and we're continuing in that. So we're in Colossians 1, if you want to turn there in your Bible. We're in chapter 1, and we're looking at verse 9 to 12 today. And so I'm just going to read that. It's a short passage. It says, "For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light." So in this passage, the Apostle Paul is praying for the Colossian church. He's praying that that church will know the will of God and that they will have wisdom and understanding so that they'll be able to show God's worth, his value, by the way they live. That's essentially a summary of this passage and this message, that the Colossian church and us, you know, the church in Holdley, that we will know God's will, that we will have wisdom and understanding, so that we can show God's worth by the way we live. And Paul prays this way because he heard of the faith of the Colossian church. And it's an interesting kind of cause and effect. Since I heard of your faith, I am praying for you in this way. So keep that in mind. There's a sequence here. Because of their faith, because they have responded to the gospel, he is praying in this way. The Colossian church heard the gospel. Someone brought it to them. A place that, you know, never would have heard of Jesus before. It was fairly recent news about Jesus. And so they heard this. They heard about the good news of Jesus, that all can come to God and worship him through Jesus. And then that gave them a new hope for life, now and in the future. It's life and fellowship with God. That is the hope that they had. And they responded to that hope by putting their trust in God through faith and by loving one another. So that's the sequence. And I'm going to refer to that a couple times, so we'll be able to come back to that. But I want to just highlight an important feature in not only this passage, but it's something that'll help you whenever you read, especially Paul's letters, but, you know, lots of the New Testament, and in fact, lots of the Bible. And that is when you see the word "you," so Paul says, since the day we heard about you, we continually ask that God will fill you. We struggle in the English language because, especially here in Canada, because we don't have a plural form of "you" that's distinct. Now, if we were in down south, what would we say? Y'all. And I think that's wonderful. I think we should adopt that. But because then I actually joked with I'm blanking on his name, the guy who chairs the translation team of the NIV. He was visiting Regent when I was there, and I had this burning question. I've had it for years, and I finally had the opportunity to ask the guy who helps basically make the decisions on this translation of the Bible. And I said, Douglas Moo, that's his name. And I said, so why don't you use y'all? And he just laughed. He said, oh, it's been talked about. Because it makes sense to use the word, to use the plural form of you, which in English is really just you all or y'all. So that's what's happening here, is that if you look at the original language, it is plural. In all of the instances of the word you, it's plural. And so it's addressed to the entire church. It's not just addressed to individuals. Of course, Paul knows individuals will be receiving it. They'll be thinking about it. They'll be talking about it. But really, it's addressed to the whole church. And it's worth keeping in mind, because our tendency is to receive the Bible as though it's God's word for me as an individual. Now, that's true, but it's incomplete if you only think of it as an individual word for you. It's only complete when you think of it in terms of our collective existence as the church. So when you're reading this on your own, if you go home and you reflect on this passage, or if you're reading much of the Bible, the New Testament especially, and the letters that are written to the churches, be thinking about how this message is supposed to transform you within the context of the church. Because the truth is that you cannot possibly live out these instructions on your own, because it's really about how we live together and how you live in the community. So I want to read this passage again, but I've interpreted it myself in a way I think that's faithful to the meaning behind it, but it's not scripture, it's an interpretation, it's my interpretation. So I think this is really what it could say. So Paul says, we know, we being Paul and Timothy, we know that your church in Colossae has received and understood the gospel, which brings eternal hope. Because you all have responded to that hope by trusting in God through faith, you are loving each other well. We are praying for you as a church family constantly. We're asking God to fill you individually and collectively as a church with knowledge of his will for your life together as followers of Jesus. We're praying that God will provide your whole church with wisdom and understanding of the spiritual forces at work among you, so that you will be able to discern what is true and untrue. We pray that your life together, how you love and care for one another, will demonstrate the character of God, showing that everything you do depends on his power and his wisdom. As you depend on God together, your church will be able to joyfully endure the challenges of trying to be a family made up of all sorts of different people who would not normally find themselves in each other's company. We pray that you'll support one another through all of life's ups and downs, knowing that in doing so, you'll be an example of how God empowers his people to remain faithful. We pray that as you remind each other of all the blessings of God available to you as his adopted children, that your gratitude will overflow and be contagious, causing your light to shine brightly in your community. So my hope is that this helps you kind of frame this whole passage and really the entire book as a collective instruction. If we don't do this together, we won't be able to do it at all. And so we all have to receive this, not just as personal instruction, but as instruction for us and life together. So the point that I want to make is that life with God, and today in particular, we're talking about wisdom, that life in God and wisdom is communal. Wisdom is not an isolated character trait or skill or progression in life. It's not an individual thing that you can have. Wisdom is always communal. It's explored communally in community, and it's expressed in community. And so when we think about receiving from God his wisdom, we need to understand that it will never be complete until we are curious about how God is revealing his truth through others. So this requires a humble posture and a sincere desire to have my understanding of God and his will be made complete through the community. So with that in mind, I just want to do a quick review of last week because it'll build. Like I said, there's a sequence. So last week I was talking about a fruit-bearing church. So Paul writes that he and his pastoral apprentice, Timothy, are pleased to hear that their pastor, Epaphras, has brought them the gospel and they've responded to the gospel. And their response is bearing fruit in the lives of their church and in their community. And it's bearing fruit because they're expressing their eternal hope, the hope that they have because of the gospel. They're expressing that hope through faith and love. And so last week I shared how faith, hope, and love are inseparable characteristics of a fruitful church. These things, in this passage in particular, it starts with hope. Hope produces faith and love. And these things always work together. Paul mentions these three words together in other passages as well. Faith, hope, and love. And each characteristic is both a source and evidence of a church that's alive. So if we want to be a living church, not just an organization, not just an event, if we really want to be alive in our community and bring the gospel, then we will express our hope in the gospel through faith and love. And that starts with us together, doing that together. These things don't come automatically and they don't come quickly. It takes time. It's not instant. We fail. Individually we fail. We fail collectively so often. And it's hard to keep on that track. And that's why we gather together. And it's important to gather together, not just Sunday morning, but in different times during the week. And we serve together and we do things together, like Saturday. It's going to be a great example of what the church is really here for, serving, loving one another through giving, through collecting things and distributing them. It's a great example of the love that God intended for his church to express in the world. And so the church in Colossae was doing this. Their understanding of the hope of the gospel was bearing fruit in the form of faith and love. And so for that reason, Paul is saying he's praying that their knowledge of God's will and their wisdom and understanding of spiritual things will increase. So there's that progression. So first comes hearing of the gospel. That's the first thing. You need to hear the gospel. You need to hear the true message that Jesus came as God's son. He is God from the beginning of time. He has been God. And he came in the form of a human. And as a human, he lived a perfect life. And even though he lived a perfect life, he was accused of sin by the Jewish leaders, and they had him crucified. And so he died from the crucifixion, but he didn't stay dead. He was raised to life, and now he lives as a human person, fully God, fully human. He still lives, and he will be returning. So that's the gospel. He'll be returning, and he's going to claim the throne over all the earth. He's going to be king over all the earth. And that is the message, and that is where we place our hope. So we hear the gospel, we understand the implications of the gospel message, that there is an eternal life to be had, that when we die, that is not the end. That's our hope. It gives us faith. It gives us the ability to love. And so out of the hope that we have, we are obedient to Jesus. So that's the next thing in the sequence. So we hear the gospel message, we understand its implications, it gives us hope, and then we obey. Notice the sequence there. It is not we obey, and then God approves of us. And I know that if you've been exposed to this you know, these messages long enough or heard them a few times, you'll already know that in your head, and you'll never be surprised to hear that. You know, preacher comes up and says, you know, God does not approve of you because of your obedience. He approves of you because of Christ's obedience, because he was perfectly obedient, and his obedience is put on you, and therefore you are accepted by God, not because of anything you've done. That should never surprise anyone, but it is so hard to live according to that way. And so it's a constant coming back to that, that the obedience flows out of the free gift of salvation. And that's the right order. We are given the gospel, we are given the hope of eternal life, and out of that we obey, and we live a life of with a desire to please God, to love others. And it's a lifelong journey. It's not something we do instantly, and now we can always obey. We increasingly become more and more obedient to God. And then as we'll see in this passage today, that as we obey, we increase in our knowledge and our wisdom and our understanding. And that will eventually show the character of God in our lives, individually and together. And ultimately, this pleases God. And then the whole thing gets reproduced to others. That's the process of discipleship. So I'll come back to this again, the sequence again. So don't worry about if you don't remember, but I'll come back to it again later. So we'll focus on the topic of wisdom, especially these three questions, which are in the outline if you have it. There's three questions about wisdom. The first is, what is it? What is wisdom? The second is, how do we get it? And I'm specifically focusing on, as a church, how do we get wisdom? And then how do we know we have it? What's the evidence of wisdom for us individually and especially collectively? So first of all, what is wisdom? What is wisdom? All throughout history, humanity has been seeking wisdom in some form or another. Typically, this is done, professionally it's done by philosophers. So that's, philosophy is a study of wisdom, is trying to understand how does the world work, and how do we do it best? How do we do life in the best way possible? And if you want to learn about wisdom from the Bible, where would be sort of the first place you would turn? Yes, Proverbs. Proverbs is probably the first place you would turn because it begins this way. It says, the Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, for gaining wisdom. It's the first verse, for gaining wisdom, and instruction for understanding words of insight, for receiving instruction in prudent behavior, doing what is right and just and fair. So these are principles, these are instructions for being wise, living in a wise way. And there's actually a category of books in the Old Testament that Proverbs is a part of. It's called the wisdom literature. And so the book of Job is another one. It's another wisdom book. And it's basically just a long story about a good and godly man who goes through incredible suffering and loss. And the whole message of the book of Job is that God is still present, even in the midst of the darkest, absolute darkest of times in your life. And all through the whole book, we're reminded not only of Job's suffering and the pain that he experienced, but also the faith that he had in a God who still is good, who still is worthy of praise. And in the end of Job, God blesses Job by giving him even more than he had before. And then another book in wisdom literature is called Ecclesiastes. And if you've ever looked, or even if you flip open to Ecclesiastes and you read a few verses, you might think, oof, this is rough. this guy is really pessimistic. And it's Solomon as well that's written this. And we find that if you read the whole book of Ecclesiastes as a whole, you can see that it actually affirms the goodness of God and the joys of life. And I do want to read just a short section of it. It says in chapter 7, verse 4 to 6, it says, the heart of the wise is in the house of mourning. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning. But the heart of fools is in the house of pleasure. It is better to heed the rebuke of a wise person than to listen to the song of fools. Like the crackling of thorns under the pot, so is the laughter of fools. This too is meaningless. So Solomon's concerned about, you know, meaning and purpose in life. And what he's saying is that you will find meaning and purpose through mourning, through suffering. This is a message that's not popular. And I think even in the church, we tend to not want to talk about that. That not only will we go through suffering, even after we start following Jesus, even after we get this hope of eternal life, we will experience suffering. We will experience pain. And we're called to walk with people who are going through suffering and pain. And not only will that happen, but what this is saying, and really it's all throughout Scripture, it's saying that if you want to experience true wisdom, true fellowship with God, true hope, you will actually intentionally enter into suffering. And this is not something to apply to every aspect of life, like you can't enjoy life. The point is that if you're really searching, if you're really wondering where wisdom comes from, ask yourself this question: have you been running away from suffering? Have you been running away from pain? Have you been running away from discomfort? If you have, that may be why you're not experiencing the joy and the hope and the wisdom of God. So one author has defined wisdom this way: wisdom is about the paths that lead to shalom. I talked about this last week. What is shalom? Shalom is peace. That's the direct translation. Shalom is a Hebrew word. It's not just peace of heart, like an inner peace. Shalom is the peace that encompasses every area of life, really holistic peace. So wisdom is about the paths that lead to life, to shalom, and to flourishing. Wisdom refers to a very wide range of desires, behaviors, skills, beliefs, all of which, like the spokes of a wheel, find their hub in the order that God has created into our world. So it's all about connecting everything we do, everything we believe, everything we think about, every desire we have, every activity we pursue, connecting that to the will of God. There's a lot to talk about in terms of wisdom. I also want to point out a few things in the New Testament. We read, passages from Jesus, talks about wisdom. We read in many of the letters that are written by different authors. There's lots about wisdom. They had to teach the early church about true wisdom because there were people in their sphere of influence that were students of Greek philosophy. And so there were mixed messages coming in. One of the prominent Greek philosophers was Plato, and Plato believed in all kinds of things that sounded so close to Christianity in many ways, but they were distortions. And so they had to teach true wisdom so that they could discern what was from God and what was from humans. And so this is part of the main purpose of Colossians. Paul wants to remind them of the truth because they are being influenced not only by the Greek philosophers, but by the Jewish traditions. And Paul is saying, no, you know, let's come back to God's true wisdom, which is found in Christ. And so for the church today, in a special way, in a unique way, wisdom requires discipline and discernment. So it always has. Wisdom has always required discipline and discernment. But in a special way, it's required of us because we are given access to virtually all the knowledge in the world at our fingertips. This is a huge blessing, but it's also a huge burden. It can be very dangerous. Because if you have a question about something, you don't need to really think about it. You don't need to wrestle with it. You can just ask the internet, and you'll be given an answer. And you'll be given an answer that maybe will seem right. It will seem helpful. And so then it's easy to jump from question to answer really, really quickly. and think that, okay, I'm good, I know the answer. So take, for example, when you're cooking. If you want to make something and you don't know how, well, it's pretty easy. Just go online, do a search for a recipe, and you'll probably find a recipe. And only after you finish a recipe, you'll find out if it was a good recipe or not. Perhaps you want to make a fruit salad. Now, this is something you shouldn't need a recipe for, in my opinion, but some people might. Some people might not know. Well, you know, I know my grandma used to make a really good fruit salad. What did she do? I have no idea what was in there. And so maybe if you do a Google search, the first thing you'll come upon is a list of fruits. So, okay, well, basic, everyone should know what a fruit is. So apples, oranges, bananas, pumpkin, squash, tomato. Well, it's, you know, they're fruit, so let's put it in a fruit salad. Well, that is misapplied knowledge, obviously, because if you try to put tomato in a fruit salad, you're not going to be flourishing, I'll tell you that much. So one of my instructors, he said the difference between knowledge and wisdom is knowledge is knowing that a tomato is a fruit, because it is technically a fruit, but wisdom is knowing not to put tomato in a fruit salad. So that's the difference. And what we have is a problem with an abundance of knowledge and a lack of wisdom. And wisdom comes through experience. And when it comes to spiritual things, wisdom comes through painful experiences most often. Experiences that we were willing to walk through in its entirety. Now, you can look at this list of fruits and you can say, you know what, I'm going to make the fruit salad with pumpkin, with squash, with tomato, with apples and oranges. I'm going to do it because technically they're fruits and technically they should be able to go together. And only once you actually go through that process, the painful experience of eating it, will you gain wisdom if you're that determined to do it. So in Colossians, Paul is praying that the church will be filled with wisdom and understanding so that they can walk in the Lord, so they can bear fruit, so they can grow, so they can be strengthened, and ultimately show the world the greatness of God. We need both knowledge and wisdom for that. These are the paths that lead to life, peace, and flourishing. So next, let's consider how we become a wise church. How do we become a wise church? And I want to highlight two main ways that we become a wise church. The first is through prayer. Now, this is really obvious. It should be obvious, but it's often left unsaid, so I want to say it now. The first way we become wise is through prayer. And Paul's modeling this. This is a prayer, after all, in Colossians. He's modeling how we pray for wisdom. He's praying that they'll increase in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, which is foundational for giving glory to God. And we're also given an example of prayer from Jesus in John 17. Doesn't use the word wisdom, but it's very close. He says, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world. See, he knows that in order to be wise, in order to be effective, we actually have to go through the trials that the world is going to throw at us. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. So it's an interesting prayer. He prays that we, his followers, will be sanctified by the truth. And to be sanctified essentially means to be set apart, to be useful. That's what they were doing, that when they sanctified something in the temple, they had to prepare a sacrifice, they had to prepare the instruments in the temple so that they would be useful for worshiping God. And they did that through the process of sanctification by the blood of animals. And we are sanctified by the blood of Jesus. His perfect life poured out for us sanctifies us, sets us apart. And so he's asking God the Father to prepare us to be useful to him by showering us with the truth. And this is the first and primary way we get wisdom. If it doesn't start with this, and if it doesn't include this, if the pursuit of wisdom doesn't begin and continue in prayer, then it will quickly fade away. And we will be following all sorts of different ideas and philosophies. So it's daily prayer, individual, corporate, prayer in our heads, silently, out loud, with our families, with our spouses, our children, our grandchildren, prayer together, for each other, with each other, for the world, for our community. In all of these things, we include the seeking of wisdom. And then the second way we become wise is humility. So I brought this, and this was a last-minute addition, so I don't know what I'm going to say about it exactly until just this moment, but I was compelled to bring this this morning as I talk about humility. So this is a painting. Sorry, I might be wandering off the camera view. Here you go for all the internet people. This is a painting that I bought in Uganda in March, and it's painted by a guy there. I talked to him, I met him, and I wanted to buy a painting from Uganda that was like a souvenir I wanted, and I asked him, you know, which is your favorite one, and I want to know the meaning that you had behind it. So he showed me this one, and so I bought it off of him, and I just mounted it yesterday. My dad built me a frame, and then I mounted it. It's not even quite done yet, but it'll be hanging in my office if you want to take another look at it at some point. But really, what it is it's supposed to depict an African man carrying a clay jar, you know, from the water source to the village, and as is you know often the case for those in poverty, the jar is broken, and that's all he's got to carry water. So as he's going along, the water is leaking out and dripping all over the place. And so the image that gave me is that the man carrying the jar is Jesus, and I am the jar. And so humility is the willingness to be used even though you're not fully complete. It's that acknowledgement that I am not complete, but God can still use me. Humility is stepping below where you think you should be for us humans. For Jesus, it was different because he is complete. Jesus is complete, and yet he humbled himself, and he made himself weak as we are, so that we would have a Savior who identifies with us. And it really was the only way to bring salvation to humanity, was for him to become human, broken, and weak. And so now he carries us around, broken vessels, on his shoulder as we go through the world. And the beautiful thing about this image is that, I see Jesus filling us, broken vessels, with his Spirit. And as he's carrying us around, we're leaking all over the place. But what are we leaking? We're leaking the presence of God. That's what's coming up. And we think we're not a worthy vessel because we're broken, but God says, no, I'm using that brokenness to spread my presence and my blessing in places that maybe you wouldn't think to spread. You know, obviously the water is meant to go to a particular place. And so on the way, it's going all over the place. It's going everywhere. And so it's an image, you know, I continue to go back to that image because it reminds me that it's okay that I'm broken. It's okay that I'm not perfect and I can't do everything perfectly. In fact, it's actually a good thing. It's actually a good thing. So there's lots more. I have more to say about that. But if you want to explore this idea further, I'd encourage you to read a book by Andy Crouch. It's called Strong and Weak. Strong and Weak. And it's about the idea that that, you know, let me read this. I'm actually going to do this. I might skip something else because I think this is really important. In Philippians 2, I preached on this in my candidating message, and it's going to be, you know, I hope you eventually get tired of hearing this because it means it's really sunk in. But I'm going to come back to this over and over again because it's central to the gospel. In Philippians 2, verse 3 to 7, it says this: "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness." So the way that Jesus expressed his power and his perfection, the way that he expressed it was through sacrifice. And so if we think that being great in God's kingdom and being worthy of God's blessing means that we have to become some great leader or some great powerful person, that's not what Jesus did. He became a servant. And it wasn't him, you know, the way the translation reads, it can sound like Jesus gave up his power so that he could be human. But the way that I read it and the way that some people read it is that Jesus was expressing his power fully by becoming human and dying for us. That was the fullest expression of power that we have ever seen and ever will see. The fullest expression of power is Jesus coming as a human, using his sovereign power and his sovereign wisdom to become a sacrifice. And that's what he calls us to. And so if we want to be wise in the way of Jesus, if we want to be wise as a church, we'll ask ourselves, how can we use our power collectively and individually to be a sacrifice for the benefit of others? How can we demonstrate the power and the majesty of God and all of the resources that God has for us? How can we demonstrate that in a way that helps others flourish? We'll come back to this theme, the connection between humility and wisdom, in chapter 2, so later in the series. But I wanted to include this as a primary way of getting wisdom, because there's a natural connection between wisdom being a gift from God and the concept in scripture that God blesses the humble. So there's lots of passages. Psalm 25 verse 9 says that he leads the humble in doing right, teaching them his way. In 1 Peter 5 verse 5 and 6, it talks about how God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. So there's a connection all throughout scripture between the blessings of God and those who are humble. And it's a principle that can be applied to all of life. Are you taking a posture of humility in the way that you treat your spouse, your children, your parents, your neighbors, your coworkers, your employer, your employees, the guy who cut you off in traffic? Are you taking a posture of humility, using your power as a sacrifice for the flourishing of other people? So if we are to grow in our collective wisdom, we will need to have a posture of humility. This means deferring to another's preferences, not exerting our power over them. Okay, question three, this will be very quick. So how do we know we're a wise church? Okay, there's a sequence again, right? First comes hearing the gospel, then understanding the implications of the gospel message, then the hope of eternal life with God, then obedience to Jesus' teaching in the form of trusting God through faith and loving others, then increased knowledge of God's will, wisdom, and understanding, resulting in showing the character of God through how we live. So how do we know we have wisdom? We're showing the character of God through how we live. That is the fruit of wisdom. This idea of worthiness, it says, you know, Paul says in other places, let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. There's this idea of worthiness that comes up. And Jesus says in Matthew 10, anyone who loves the father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And this word worthy trips us up because we think that we have to somehow be worthy, make ourselves worthy of God. And so is Paul saying and is Jesus saying that we need to prove our love for Jesus in order to be accepted by him? We have to prove something to him? Not at all. They're saying that when we demonstrate that Jesus is our greatest treasure, when we demonstrate the character of God through how we love one another, through our faith, that is when we are proving his worth, proving his value. To live a life worthy of the Lord, we need to live in a way that proves how valuable the gospel is in our life. It has nothing to do with our own merit. It has, again, this is a, you know, the sequence you got to keep in mind. We receive the gospel and then we live out the gospel in our life because it's so valuable to us. If we're not living out the gospel in our life, the question is, well, how valuable is it to you? If it's not transforming your life, then how much value are you placing on the salvation that Jesus has given you? Is it something you've just tacked onto your life as sort of a resource for, like, good living? Or is it everything? Is it everything that drives you? It's about cherishing what we've been given. When a child receives a toy that they love and they cherish, they bring it everywhere they go. They show it off to everybody. They talk about it. They're obsessed with it. And like a child, we need to be obsessed with the gospel. Everywhere we go, it affects how we think, what we're thinking about. And so in Colossians, Paul is saying that when you are filled with the knowledge of God's will through wisdom and understanding, you will live a life that proves the infinite value of God. When you are filled with his knowledge and wisdom, you will live a life that proves the infinite value of God. Would you stand with me as we pray and commit these things to the Lord? Heavenly Father, we know that we will not do this perfectly. And I just pray for each one of us here that we will receive these words from you, not as a burden, not as something that we need to now prove to you how much we love you or anything like that, but that we would receive your salvation as a gift, and out of that gift, we are compelled. We can't help but to pursue you and your wisdom for life. Help us to do that. Bring these things to mind throughout the week as we seek to live as your people here in Wlliam. In Jesus' name, amen.